Do you want to know how you can make yourself as resilient as possible to layoffs? If you're working in the tech industry, then you've likely seen that there have been a lot of layoffs happening over the past couple of years. Now, while some of this is due to just natural economic cycles and business cycles, some of it is also to do with trends in the industry shifting. So what I want to do in this video is give you some tips on what you can do to best position yourself so that you're not the one who's actually let go of. And if you're looking to come into the industry, so you're someone who's new to tech and you want to move into, for example, cloud engineering or cloud AI engineering, then this should also serve as some tips which you can use to make sure that you have the right skills in order to land the job in the first place. My name is Neil Davis, and I've worked in the tech industry for over 25 years. And for more than 20 years of that, before I started my cloud training business, Digital Cloud Training, I was working as an employee for many large global organizations. Now, in those roles, I did see layoffs many, many times. In fact, I'd probably say that every couple of years, there was a round of layoffs. And those layoffs would often affect people very close to me, people I worked with, even sat next to as well. Now, during all of that time, I was never laid off myself. So what did I do to make sure that I wasn't one of the ones who was laid off when these rounds of redundancies actually happened? Now, of course, there is no silver bullet that's going to protect you from any situation. There are going to be situations where companies cut back even their best people. Sometimes it's because companies are failing. Sometimes it might be because a department is being closed down, for example. But in most cases, what's happening is companies are literally just looking to lower costs, or maybe they're trying to increase their share value because there's some issues in the business and they want to lower their costs, as that's one way to make it look like they're making more money. So if we imagine ourselves in a room with the executives, what they're going to be doing is saying, okay, how can we cut operational costs in the business without impacting the business? Okay, they don't want to impact the business. If they're not worried about that and they really need to cut costs, then they're probably in an even worse situation. Something's really bad in the business, and that means everybody's job's at risk. In most cases, that isn't the case. And so what they're doing is they're saying, well, how can we reduce operational costs without negatively impacting the business? So they need to then look at staff cuts as one of those options. And when they're looking at who to actually get rid of, they need to start thinking about, okay, how can we make sure that the people we cut back are not going to affect the ongoing business and any projects and areas of the business where we really want to start developing new lines of business or perhaps helping to drive more profitability into the business. Now, this is where there's two aspects that I want to focus on. The first one is more sort of behavioral. And what I'm talking about here is they're going to be thinking about who are the people, and they're going to be asking the various different managers who manage different parts of the business and saying, well, who are the people that you want to make sure that you keep hold of because you see that they're ambitious, they're keen, they want to learn more, they're constantly looking for, you know, being able to deliver more value to the business. You want to try and keep hold of those people, right? Those are the gold that you really want to keep in the business, the A players that you always want to retain as best as you can. So if you're working in a business, you want to make sure you're one of those people. If you're somebody who's quiet, doesn't really speak a lot, doesn't really show a lot of new initiative, or you're not looking for new opportunities to help the business drive more growth and going above and beyond, then you could easily be passed up here and pushed to the side. So that's the behavioral piece, always making sure that we demonstrate that we're an A player, that we're constantly looking for new initiatives, bringing new ideas to the business, delivering more value, working hard, try and stay connected as best as possible to people in the business so that you're very well known and well liked. And then also we have to, of course, have the right skills. So the skills piece is where I was always really keen to develop constantly throughout my career. And I think you have to have that attitude. You have to know that in tech, you need to undertake constant and never-ending education. So every year I was doing certifications, every year I was learning something new. And I was always looking for what are the trends in technology, but also aligning that to my business as well. So where would I like to see my skills going? And in some cases, I will say that what I did was I learned technologies, even though there was not really a lot of opportunity in the business I was in, but it was such a major shift in the industry that I wanted to start looking for other work, moving companies if I needed to, in order to get into those particular areas of technology. So when you see major emerging trends, that's something to think about. Outside of that, you want to make sure that you're aligning to whatever's happening in your industry. If I heard that my company was starting to think about moving to Amazon Web Services and I didn't have those skills, I'm going to start learning the cloud and getting certified. And I'm going to do that on my own dollar, in my own time. I'm just going to get started immediately. I'm not going to wait for anyone to fund my training or anything like that. Now, of course, in the industry today, we're seeing a massive shift towards artificial intelligence. That is actually driving a lot of opportunities in cloud, because most of these AI-enabled applications are being built in the cloud, where companies like Amazon Web Services are building out so many capabilities and making it easy for an organization to come along and develop their applications using existing machine learning services, existing Gen AI services in the cloud. So cloud engineering is a growing job in the cloud, as is cloud AI engineering, of course, as well, and cloud architecture. As more companies are moving workloads into the cloud and then trying to build AI capabilities, these are all great job roles to move into. And I'd say whichever one you go into, get some AI skills to make sure that you have that edge. A lot of companies today are saying that they're looking for AI skills in all of their new hires. So in summary, make sure that within your company, you're well known, that you're constantly showing initiative and that you're an A player that the company needs to keep hold of, and then make sure that you've got the right skills. So look for those emerging trends, make sure you're learning the right technologies. For me, that's Amazon Web Services, cloud engineering, and cloud AI engineering as well, because that is a really in-demand skill this year. Now, of course, I do have a training program, so if anyone's interested in training with me and my organization, you can check the link in the description of this video and learn how our Cloud Mastery Bootcamp can help you develop the skills that you need to succeed in a career in cloud.